Something again?
Well, I believe I have. The problem is, I can't remember what. Oh, well, I'm sure it'll come to me.
Where are you off to?
To return this book to Père Robert. It's about two lovers in Fair Verona.
Sounds boring.
Look, there she goes, that's going strange, no question.
Dazed and distracted, can't you tell?
Get a part of any crowd, cause her head's up on some cloud. But tonight she's a funny girl that
set.
This is Michael Faulkner, and it is showtime at the March 14th, 2017 edition of the Weekly Podioplex, brought to you on the Chronicriff Network. This week's birthdays include Jamie Alexander, Jane from Blindspot, and Lady Sif from the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Aaron Eckhart and Michael Caine, both from The Dark Knight, Grace Park, Boomer from Battlestar Galactica, Victor Garber, Professor Stein from DC's Legends of Tomorrow, Lauren Graham, Lorelei from The Gilmore Girls, John Boyega, Finn from Star Wars The Force Awakens, and Alan Tudyk, Wash from Firefly, K2SO from Rogue One A Star Wars Story, and Hey the Chicken from Moana. He is a leaf on the wind. Starting with the box office report, is that a monkey? At number 10 is 50 Shades Darker, down one from 9th. At number 9 is La La Land, up 1 from 10th, with a small bump in screening numbers. At 8 is John Wick Chapter 2, down 3 from 5th. In 7th is Hidden Figures, once again holding steady from last week. And finishing up the 6th bottom 5 is Before I Fall, also holding position from last week's debut. The top 5 this week begin with the Lego Batman movie, down 1 from 4th with $7.6 million, toward a $158.8 million total. In 4th place is The Shack, down 1 from 3rd with $10 million and a total of $32.2 million. In 3rd place is Get Out, down 1 from 2nd with $20.7 million for a total of $110.7 million. In 2nd is last week's winner, Logan, slicing off another $38.1 million for a new total of $152.9 million. And in 1st place this week is Kong, Skull Island, debuting the second chapter in Legendary's Monsterverse with $61 million. In comparison, that's well behind 2014's Godzilla, the first movie in this series, but it does beat the comparable San Andreas from 2015, as well as Pacific Rim and The Legend of Tarzan. Even though Kong is falling behind Godzilla on our shores, he is rampaging overseas, outperforming the giant lizard in markets like the UK, Russia, and Mexico. Hey, Kong's a huge hit in Korea, coming in 90% ahead of Godzilla. Opening weekend audiences here gave Kong Skull Island a B-plus cinema score, which is right on par with Godzilla. Moviegoers under the age of 25 bumped that up to an A cinema score. Critics were also impressed with an 80% positive reception. Kong wasn't the only winner this week, as both Logan and Get Out finished strong for veteran performers, and this weekend came in around 4% higher than the same time last year. Let's close out the box office report with a look at what was winning in years gone by. 5 years ago in 2012, 21 Jump Street took number one with $36.3 million. 10 years ago in 2007, 300 won the weekend for a second week with $32.9 million. 20 years ago in 1997, Star Wars Episode VI, Return of the Jedi Special Edition, was the winner with $16.3 million. 30 years ago in 1987, Lethal Weapon took the title for a second week with $7.1 million. And 40 years ago, in 1977, Airport 77 took the box office crown with $3.6 million. The box office premieres for St. Patrick's Day begin with a tale as old as time. This week's headliner is Beauty and the Beast, a fantasy musical starring Emma Watson, Dan Stevens, and Luke Evans.
There's something sweet and almost kind, but he was mean and he was coarse and unrefined. And now he's dear and so unsure, I wonder why I didn't see it there before.
She glanced this way, I thought I saw. When we touched, she didn't shudder at my paw. No, it can't be, I'll just ignore. But then she's never looked at me that way before.
This is the live-action adaptation of the Disney fairy tale about a monstrous-looking prince and a young woman who fall in love. There's been a lot of controversy over the last couple weeks about Josh Gad's character LeFou and his sexual orientation. Here's a little secret. LeFou's been gay since the beloved 1991 animated classic. Beauty and the Beast is rated PG. The other wide release this week is The Belko Experiment, a horror thriller starring John Gallagher Jr., Tony Goldwyn, and Adria Arjona.
Stop putting words in my mouth.
I'm sorry, but that sounds to me like you're saying you want to kill innocent people.
No, I am not saying that at all. I'm saying that we need to discuss all our options.
Well, we understand, but we are not going to entertain the option of killing people.
What, do you got a mouse in your pocket there, Melch?
Mr. Norris has a point.
Absolutely he does. Look, we have to think about what is best for the whole group. All right, look, I know no one wants to actually think about sacrificing 30 lives, but if it means saving the lives of an additional...
It really doesn't matter what the circumstances are. We do not have the right to take innocent human lives.
Yeah, that's it.
And besides that, there are practical reasons.
Like what?
You can't really think that they're gonna let anybody live to tell about this.
In a twisted social experiment, 80 Americans are locked in their high-rise corporate office in Bogota, Colombia, and ordered by an unknown voice coming from the company's intercom system to participate in a deadly game of kill or be killed. The Belko Experiment is rated R. There are also 5 titles on this week's limited slate, and you can find those in the show notes. Next up is a look at the home entertainment slate for the week of March 10th, and I'll start with new releases on DVD and Blu-ray, and that list begins with Fences, a period drama starring Denzel Washington, Viola Davis, and McKelty Williamson. An African-American father struggles with race relations in the United States while trying to raise his family in the 1950s and coming to terms with the events of his life. Fences is rated PG-13. The second title is Collateral Beauty, a drama starring Will Smith, Keira Knightley, and Kate Winslet. A tragic event sends a New York ad man on a downward spiral. Collateral Beauty is rated PG-13. The third title is Passengers, a science fiction drama starring Jennifer Lawrence, Chris Pratt, and Michael Sheen. A spacecraft transporting thousands of people to a distant colony planet has a malfunction in one of its sleep chambers, and a single passenger is awakened 90 years early. Passengers is rated PG-13. The fourth title is Marco Polo, a television miniseries from 2007 starring Ian Somerhalder, B.D. Wong, and Desiree Ann Sheehan. Assigned to accompany two priests on a mission to convert the court of Kublai Khan to Christianity, Marco Polo is abandoned in the mountains when the priests, doubting the very existence of China, turn back. Polo eventually pushes bravely forth alone toward the fabled country where he is accepted as an envoy into Khan's court. Marooned on the far side of the world, Polo, accompanied by his servant Pedro, advances as a Mongol grandee for 20 extraordinary years. What he eventually brings back with him to the West is a chronicle that changed history forever. Marco Polo is not rated. Swinging my new releases on digital video, I have 2 titles there. The first is Patriot's Day, a historical drama thriller starring Mark Wahlberg, John Goodman, and Kevin Bacon. This is the story of the 2013 Boston Marathon bombing and the aftermath, which includes the citywide manhunt to find the terrorists responsible. Patriots Day is rated R. The second title is Miss Sloane, a drama starring Jessica Chastain, Gugu Mbatha-Raw, and Mark Strong. An ambitious lobbyist faces off against the powerful gun lobby in an attempt to pass gun control legislation. Miss Sloane is rated R. Moving right along to TV on DVD and Blu-ray, this week brings a selection of retro titles. The first is Chips, Season 5 from 1981, starring Larry Wilcox, Eric Estrada, and Robert Pine. Eric Estrada and Larry Wilcox star in this high-speed series as California Highway Patrol officers Frank Ponch Poncherello and Jonathan John Baker. Friends and partners who ride the Los Angeles freeways on their choppers, chasing down criminals, and more often than not, sharing a few good-natured laughs. This season marks Wilcox's last in the starring role of John, but there are still plenty of crimes to solve and adventures to be had. Like when a motorcycle star gets himself arrested before he can perform at a benefit show, so John decides to perform the stunts himself. Or when Ponch moonlights as a technical advisor on action-adventure film, but it isn't long before the real action soon heats up. The second TV title is Newhart, Season 8 from 1989, starring Bob Newhart, Mary Fran, and Peter Scolari. It's checkout time at the Stratford. Join innkeepers Dick and Joanna Luden for the 8th and final season of the fantastically funny, Emmy-nominated comedy Newhart. Comedy legend Bob Newhart as button-down and bemused Dick heads up a hilarious cast of inmates, including Dick's wife Joanna, handyman George, materialistic marrieds Stephanie and Michael, and the mostly mute trio of wacky woodsmen Larry, his brother Daryl, and his other brother Daryl. Season 8's 24 episodes hit a new high in delivering the beloved quirky humor and oddball situations that made the show a hit throughout its primetime run. And the conclusion of the Stratford saga is a masterpiece that is still considered one of the all-time great final episodes in television history. Number 3 on our list is Pee-wee's Playhouse, the complete series, spanning 1986 to 1991 and starring Paul Rubens, John Paragon, and Phil Hartman. All 45 wacky episodes, including Pee-wee's Playhouse Christmas Special, have been meticulously remastered from the original film elements, and now you can see this groundbreaking series for the very first time in beautiful high definition. Scream along to the secret word with Pee-wee Herman and his pals Jombie the Genie, Miss Yvonne, Cowboy Curtis, Reba the Mail Lady, Captain Carl, Magic Screen, Conky, Globy, Cherry, Terry, Randy, and so many more. The final TV title this week is The Zeta Project, Season 2 from 2002, starring Diedrich Bader, Julie Nathanson, and Daniel Nicodeme. 2040 AD. They created him to kill their enemies, but he refuses to destroy any more. Renegade synthoid Zeta, marked for reprogramming after developing a conscience and defying his evil orders, flees from a ruthless government agent. Capable of transforming himself at will into any human shape and possessing amazing cybernetic resources, Zeta joins Ro, a 15-year-old street kid in her own kind of trouble with the law. In this spin-off from the blockbuster animated series Batman Beyond, futuristic vehicles, weapons, and technology meld with the touching and humorous story of two misfits who need each other to survive in a dangerous world. I'll wrap up the home entertainment slate with Blu-rays from the past, and this week I have one title. That one is Firestarter, a horror thriller from 1984 starring Drew Barrymore, David Keith, and George C. Scott. A couple who participated in a potent medical experiment gain telekinetic ability and then have a child who is pyrokinetic. Firestarter is rated R. After this brief break for about a shameless podcast cross-promotion, the Weekly Podioplex will continue.
So how would you describe a podcast like The Shared Desk?
It's a podcast that took its sweet time to do a promo.
Well, I think that goes without saying.
I mean, you could say The Shared Desk is a podcast about collaboration, because that's what we do.
Wait. There's a lot more to The Shared Desk. You got our Loot Crate looky-loo.
Oh, what's in the box?
And then what we're doing when we're not writing. Usually it's pretty nerdy.
Nerd!
And then there are the drop-ins.
Has the whole world gone crazy?
Yes, there are drop-ins.
And we love having guests on the show. It's The Shared Desk, after all.
And if it's Katie or Lauren, you get some lovely singing as well.
So find The Shared Desk on iTunes, Stitcher, or at theshareddesk.com. The Shared Desk. Two writers,
one podcast,
different points of view.
And welcome back to the Weekly Podioplex. I'm Denise with your quick flicks. This week is all about Logan, Danny Rand, and the mighty Thor as we slide down the Rainbow Bridge into bright, supersaturated Technicolor waters. Okay, so that makes a whole lot more sense if you've seen Entertainment Weekly's new cover featuring the God of Thunder, but whatever. Anyway, first up, I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but early reviews for Iron Fist are not boding well for Netflix's third Defender. Much like Doctor Strange and Ghost in the Shell, Iron Fist has been surrounded by controversy. Like Doctor Strange, Iron Fist has come under criticism for its approach to adapting what many are viewing as outdated comic book source material. Iron Fist has also come under fire for his handling of both Asian and Asian American culture, like Ghost in the Shell, drawing accusations that Danny Rand is a variation on the white savior archetype. Naturally, Jones and showrunner Scott Buck have assured audiences that this is not the case. Iron Fist Season 1, like Daredevil and Jessica Jones and Luke Cage, explore the origins of its namesake. Danny Rand returns to claim his family's New York-based company after being presumed dead for 15 years, encountering new and familiar enemies along the way. Iron Fist is following behind two seasons of Daredevil, lauded for breaking new ground in the MCU for gritty tone and street-level crime drama, as well as Jessica Jones and Luke Cage, lauded for their thoughtful handling of topics like sexual assault and African-American culture. The bar was set pretty high, guys. Perhaps it is for these reasons many TV critics are already declaring Iron Fist's first season as the first real disappointment for the Marvel Netflix corner of the MCU. Daniel Feinberg from THR says, "After three straight creative successes, three above average character introductions, the partnership between Marvel and Netflix was due for a dud. This isn't to say that Daredevil, Jessica Jones, and Luke Cage have been shows without flaws. Each show, though, has had virtues of tone and aspiration that made it feel like a complicated superhero TV code had been cracked. Iron Fist feels like a step backward on every level. A major disappointment that already suffers from storytelling issues throughout the first six episodes made available to critics and would probably be mercifully skippable in its entirety if it weren't the bridge into the long-awaited Defenders crossover series." Variety's Maureen Ryan says, "Quite a few dramas in the streaming arena have pacing problems, and even Netflix's better Marvel programs have displayed an affinity for contrived, time-killing subplots. But Iron Fist is the most frustrating and ferociously boring example of Netflix drift in some time. Not one element of this plotting piece works. The action scenes lack spark, snap, and originality. None of the flat, by-the-numbers characters makes any lasting impression. And as origin stories go, the tale of Danny Rand, Finn Jones, at least, as rendered by this creative team, is about as exciting as a slice of Velveeta cheese left out in the sun too long. Susanna Polo from Polygon says, "After Jessica Jones, a revelation, Luke Cage, flawed but still brilliant, and Daredevil, outshone by the competition but still very solid, I fully expected Iron Fist to be a decent adaptation, ultimately hobbled by an unwillingness to stray too far from its dated source material. And let me be clear, Iron Fist's problems with its portrayal of Asian cultures and Asian Americans are embedded throughout every episode. It's just that its problems with delivering exposition, crafting consistent characters, and even basic dialogue, writing run. Of course, it will be up to you as the viewer to decide whether you like the show or not. Personally, I have a love-hate relationship with superheroes. I like them just fine, but as comic book choices go, superheroes are not my go-to. I prefer indie comics and lesser-known heroes like The Shadow and Delilah Dirk. And while I have thoroughly enjoyed Daredevil, Luke Cage, and Jessica Jones, I have enough of a Netflix backlog to keep Iron Fist toward the bottom of my to-watch list." Up next, Hugh Jackman will help cast the next Wolverine. When the original X-Men film came out in 2000, it was a watershed moment for the superhero movie genre, helping to usher in the golden age of comic book films audiences are currently enjoying. A key reason for this was Hugh Jackman's portrayal of Wolverine. The actor quickly became a fan favorite, playing the career-defining role 9 times over in the course of 17 years. He's long maintained this year's Logan, now playing in theaters, as the end of the line for his run as Wolverine. He supports an eventual recast of the character, but it's not something the creative team is contemplating at this point. However, should the tone change in the future, the process would involve the input of Hugh Jackman. While speaking with Deadline, producer Simon Kinberg reiterated his lack of concern with finding the next Wolverine right now, but he would seek Jackman's opinion if need be. He said, "We haven't even thought of the next iteration of Wolverine. For all of us, we were keeping our fingers crossed that the audiences would respond to Logan the way they have. I can't visualize in my head another Wolverine, but if that day ever comes, we would talk to Hugh about it." Hugh Jackman remains the one and only Logan, as far as I'm concerned. While I'm not a huge fan of the X-Men movies, I still appreciate his run as Wolverine and will eventually see Logan for myself. I hear it's great. In Deadpool news, Atlanta's Zazie Beetz is the front runner for Domino. Actually, she's been cast for Domino, but I'll get there. It's no secret the love fans have for Deadpool and the disappointment we all felt when it didn't win an Oscar. But that hasn't stopped Deadpool from charging ahead with his own plans. There's already been a ridiculously fun teaser released on social media even before the sequel's begun filming. With Easter eggs galore, the teaser has also hinted at a potential frontrunner for the role of Cable in Nathan Fillion. Meanwhile, we do know that the mercenary with luck-based powers Domino will be joining the sequel, and now we have a confirmed casting of Zazie Beetz as Domino. Ryan Reynolds' Twitter account has made it official, you guys. We also know that Sir Patrick Stewart's retirement from the X-Men universe may not be a permanent thing so long as he can play Professor X in an upcoming Deadpool film, and Rob Liefeld, the creator of Deadpool, whom I seriously wanted to meet at Emerald City Comic Con, but the lines, man, has already said Cable and Domino will blow people's minds. The inclusion of Sir Patrick Stewart may just leave us nerds comatose from awesome. In Thor Ragnarok news, Cate Blanchett's villain Hela and Sakaar has been explained. While Guardians of the Galaxy wasn't the first Marvel film to explore the MCU's cosmos, it did give us the best look of the planets and factions that exist within the multiverse. Thor's franchise has also teased various worlds and realms, but it hasn't really delivered. Until now. Thor Ragnarok has been billed as a cosmic road trip, and in doing so, is likely to flesh out the MCU's world even more. At least the cosmic version, anyway. We've already seen some colorful alien people. Again, seriously, you guys need to check out Entertainment Weekly's Thor issue. It's an acid trip of color without the actual acid. And we know the movie will partially adapt the Planet Hulk storyline that sent Bruce Banner into space. In Ragnarok, we'll see Hulk all geared up as a gladiator fighting on an alien world of Sakaar, and this will eventually put him into contact with Thor. And a fight between the two behemoths of the MCU has been teased by Chris Hemsworth. At some point, they'll make amends, as one does with the Hulk, and face the myriad of threats, which one does in space, because space. Cate Blanchett will be playing the movie's main villain, Hela, the goddess of death, the ruler of hell, ultimate badass woman. And we've had hints that Thor and his friends will somehow piss the queen of the underworld off during the film. I am excited for this movie. Remember that part where I said I wasn't really into superheroes? I'm totally into Thor. One, because I've always liked Thor. Two, because Cate Blanchett. Three, because battle between Thor and Hulk. Four, because acid trip of colors. Five, because Jeff Goldblum. Don't you judge me. Thanks to an EW cover story, Blanchett has teased just what Hela's journey in the film will be. She says, she's been locked away for millennia, getting more and more cross. And then, with a mistake, she gets unleashed and she ain't getting back in the box. Yes! An interesting point to note. Hela is imprisoned in Ragnarok. In the comics, however, she is appointed by Odin and relishes her position of power. It will be interesting how the film alters this and whether Hela is trapped in Hel or kept away from it. It does look like her accidental freedom arrives early in the flick, as her battle with Thor will be what sends him to Sakaar. Hemsworth talked a bit about the planet to EW, affirming that he too will be a gladiator in the arenas. He said, Sakaar is basically where every wormhole across the universe dumps out its trash, so you get people from all walks of life with all sorts of incredible abilities and powers. No one cares what prince or king Thor may have been in another world. Also, his strength is pretty easily matched with those he finds himself amongst. During all of the madness, we know Loki will also be popping up in the film. Last we saw, he was impersonating Odin on the throne, so it will be interesting to see how he's forced to team up with Thor, and if his ruse will be revealed, and if there will be an Easter egg nod to pre-Ragnarok Loki, fathering Hela with a frost giant in Jotunheim. I do beg the question, if Thor doesn't have Mjolnir in Ragnarok, will he retrieve it in the movie, or will he prove himself unworthy of the hammer and another take over? Will Ragnarok usher in Lady Thor? Please, dear God, don't mind me if I devoutly hope this is so. Lady Thor is one of the best comic runs out there and is one of the very few superhero comics still on my pull list. And finally, on QuickFlix, Logan X-23 curator pitches spin-off film ideas. From what I've heard, Logan is a masterpiece of a movie, at once heartbreaking and a loving send-off to one of X-Men's most beloved characters and the man who plays him. I've also heard one of the main reasons for the movie's success thus far has been the addition of Laura, otherwise known as X-23. She is portrayed by Daphne Keene, and her mixture of innocence and brutality epitomizes so much of Hugh Jackman's Logan and allows the actor to show emotional shades of Logan previously unseen in the other films. This is what I've heard anyway, I haven't seen the film yet. Given that Hugh Jackman has sworn up and down that Logan is his last run as the titular hero, thoughts are naturally beginning to turn how the character of Wolverine can continue on the big screen. The actor himself has stated he'd love to see another actor take on the Wolverine role. And since X-23 received such a positive reaction from fans and critics, many commentators are suggesting that an X-23 spin-off movie could be in Keane's future. In an interview with THR's Heat Vision, X-23's creator Craig Kyle gives his opinion on his character's live-action adaptation, stating, "I am so grateful for how they brought her to screen." And he also suggested his idea for how a spin-off movie could work in the future. He pitches, "I'd love to see some of the stories that we told in the comics. See as much as we can of how she came to be, but then really get into the stories of what she was forced to do and commit. She said she killed people. She said bad people. The bulk of who X-23 and Laura killed in the comic books were bad people, but she did kill some children. She did kill a whole press corps. I think there's something powerful about watching her go through those horrors without any say and without any ability to not take those actions. A story I always wanted to tell was once she's free and once she's gone through what she's gone through, the only way she can have a hope for a future is for her to go back and trace the lives that remained and were harmed by the actions she was forced to commit. You put her on this journey of redemption. She can go through them one by one and face everyone affected by the murder she was forced to commit. If she can get to the end of that road without being killed by those remain, there's something on the other side of that." Although the hype around X-23 is significant right now, it could taper off, and it could be argued that the character isn't well known enough yet to warrant her own spinoff, as awesome as that would be. An alternative might be to include her in other movies as part of an ensemble cast, and slowly give her bigger and bigger roles until she proves herself as an audience-grabbing character. Time will tell. I'm not a fan of the X-Men movie franchise, and I fell off reading the comics after Jean Grey's Dark Phoenix upteenth return, but I would not be averse to seeing an X-23 solo film, provided they didn't treat her as Wolverine in woman's skin. And that's it for this week's Quick Flicks. I'll see you guys next time on the Weekly Podioplex.
Thank you, Denise. And here we are once again, at the end of a new edition of the Weekly Podioplex. If you want to discuss anything you heard on this week's edition, please take a moment to get in touch. You can surf on over to our homepage at chronicrift.com and leave an audio message right there in the website using your microphone, where you can write to weeklypodioplex@gmail.com. Of course, you can still tweet us on Twitter. The Chronic Rift is chronic_rift. The Weekly Podioplex is Weekly Podioplex. Denise is Riley James Keith. And I am Womprat99, like the creature Liquid Bullseye in his T16 in Beggar's Canyon. You can give the Chronic Rift a thumbs up on Stitcher Radio, leave us a 5-star review on iTunes, and you can find the Weekly Podioplex and the Chronic Rift on Facebook and Google+. Take a moment, stop on by, and see what other shows the Chronic Rift Network has to offer. We have Cyborgs, a Bionic Podcast, the Batcave Podcast, the OSI Files Podcast, the G2V Podcast, Generations Geek, Presenting the Transcription Feature, the Dan and Travis Show, the Sci-Fi Diner Podcast, Doctor Who and Mr. Drew, and so much more. In fact, if you like game shows, John has a brand new project out called the Home Game Show Version Podcast, where he gathers contestants together to play the board game version of famous game shows. And it's all done on video. Also, if you have a Roku player, you can find us there on the Chronic Rift's Roku channel, where you can find episodes of the Chronic Rift's adventures in the 1990s, when it was a public access television show on the New York City airwaves. We've got a lot going for us here at the Rift. Check us out and find the culture in pop culture. If you're interested in more of my adventures, take a quick trip to my blog, Creative Criticality, where I'm watching every episode of Doctor Who for the first time from the very beginning of the franchise and reviewing those stories in the Timestamps Project. Right now, the blog is in the middle of the 17th season with the adventures of the Fourth Doctor and the Time Lady Romana, and I'm coming up pretty quickly on the tale called Shada. Those reviews can be found at creativecriticality.wordpress.com. You can also find Creative Criticality on Facebook. Denise can also be found on the internet at Accessories Not Included, where she talks about her writing, reviews books, and offers her services as a cover designer. Check her out at AccessoriesNotIncluded.com. If you decide to pick up any of this week's new releases, why not do it through our Amazon store? You get the newest entertainment Amazon's low prices and high quality service, and each purchase you make that store supports the Chronic Rift Network. Your support keeps us on the air, and we appreciate your consideration. Look for the links to our best bets in the network store in our show notes, or click the Amazon box on the website. The Weekly Podioplex is a Lucky Shot production and is produced by John S. Drew. On behalf of Denise and John, this is Michael Faulkner. Thanks for listening. Until next time, there are adventures and drama, comedy and action, worlds to explore in the depths of film. Get some popcorn. Find your favorite seat, and I'll see you at the theater.
That's a wrap!